is new, as much as it's a practice of unlearning old habits that have kept us from doing this. Our bodies want to do this. Our bodies crave this. From the moment of our birth, our bodies are looking and scanning for someone to be around us. I think it's amazing that our sight lines are about 18 inches, so that whoever can enter in that 18-inch personal bubble is the person that we find. Our bodies do this. Our bodies' heart rates, they found through scientific testing, can come up within 6 feet of another person, and our bodies to try to connect. Just like a whole room full of grandfather clocks seem to always somehow find their way to the same rhythm. Our hearts do that. Our body space wants to do that. Someone tells us, oh, you're in my personal bubble. I feel like we've learned that. Mm-hmm. As much as we feel it, we don't know what to do with it, and it's interpreted for us until we can unlearn that habit and move ourselves into a space that gives us this beautiful thing where our connections happen. My mother taught me this. How could she could be a master teacher? It's fun. Before my mom passed away, she wouldn't have known what hold space for all, mom, that's what you're doing. No, she was just being mom. That's what she was doing. She had this beautiful way of allowing me to ramble or scream or be whatever was the angst of growing up.
Rant.
While her full attention was on me. She could, I don't know, I just really don't know how she could do it. And the beautiful thing was she was able to keep me safe. My mom was 5'1", I'm not. And I never felt more safe than I was with her in those moments. She was beautiful at doing that. When I would ask, and until I would ask, she would wait to give me her perspective. Not a commandment on what to do, but a thoughtful nugget of her wisdom. She seemed to embody something that I didn't have. And I think a lot of ways I didn't have it because of my makeup, my body. What she seemed to embody to me is something I see in another mom. Something I've seen in another mom that was able to hold space for her son, probably when he didn't even realize she was doing it. We get to tap into that. The space that Mary held for Jesus, it's incredible. Mary shows us the difference between holding space in our head and holding space in our heart. Mary's ability to ponder the thoughts of what was going on is an incredible story. If you haven't read it, read it with the idea of her holding the space for her son. I get to do this. It's pretty cool. Just last night, one of my little granddaughters was looking at pictures of me and Karen from more than a decade ago. And who's that? Was her question. Well, that's Granddaddy. He looks weird. So, of course, as soon as that happens, you get a FaceTime call from the parent going, ha, you look weird. And so she's telling me that doesn't look like you. That's not you. And then she's looking at FaceTime and she says, that's you. And I realized the space that was being held by her. And in my heart, I'm going, but I was there too. That body didn't look like me, but I was there. That body's shape has enlarged in areas and face things have lowered in areas, but I was there. And I said, you see that little girl standing there? That's your mom. That's your mom. And she's here too. That beautiful space that I can see Mary holding. When the angel first visited and said, oh, and by the way, you're going to birth a child. What? And then the whole time she held that moment and held her heart. She pondered it. Pondering is not a head thing, it's a heart thing. She pondered it. I'm sure she pondered it a lot. What does this mean? What? 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 The Son of God. A lot of pondering. Mm-hmm. To the moment she went to the temple. Do you remember that story? When a woman walks up and says, I've waited, I've held on all my life to hold this child. And this mother goes, then hold him. And mom steps back and watches this happen. And she ponders it in her heart. She held that space for Jesus, for that woman, for us. And then finally, we see another space that she held. And the power that I want to tell you guys was for all of us to hold space like this happened at the cross. Mary held that space so much. Who was the last to leave? Who was the ones not to run away? That mom, a couple other Marys, held that space. Held that space where her baby hung on the cross. He didn't look like the first little baby, but she knew who he was. And she held that space, pondering it, holding it. Each person in this room has that ability. We have that ability as humans to hold space for one another just like that. That's what our community covenant is pushing us to do, wanting us to be, helping us to learn that understanding. There's a woman in my life that was one of my incredible teachers, Dr. Barbara Holmes. Dr. Barbara Holmes, I was able to sit at the feet of her for 2 years and listen to her speak about the black church and about how, oh my goodness, things I just didn't know. Dr. Holmes is from the Gullah tradition where she hears and knows her ancestors' thoughts and sees things and the ancestors move through and help her see Christ in ways that she couldn't see Christ. And she turned this pondering of Mary into a term that I could hold on to, that I think we could hold to. She calls it communal pondering. And she says communal pondering occurs when a group of people are listening together and are opening up new paths for discourse and action by the engaged reflection that takes place within that listening. Communal pondering is also about communal experience of the divine, or more particularly, a communal listening and entry into the communion with the living God. And this is from her book, Joy Unspeakable. This word listening, I don't know if you saw it last week when we were asked about how do you show respect to someone. Listening was probably the number one answer that we saw for showing respect to another person is to listen to them. Listening was a way of letting someone know your presence is with them. The communal listening works the same way. There's a group that's called the Compassionate Listening Project. If you've never heard of them, you should look them up. They began in Palestine. And they started taking Palestinians and Israelis, putting them in a room together. That might sound like a scary thing for some to do. But what they wanted to do is say, listen. Just listen to each story. And listen compassionately with your heart. Listen and hold that space. A space that their nations couldn't even hold. A space that the rulers and authorities around them said, it can't be done. The only space, the way we can hold this space is with weapons and bombs and this. No. They took and they held that space. Well, the Compassionate Listening Project, as you can imagine, has expanded worldwide. Worldwide. One of their last stories I read was a Compassionate Listening Project that's happening in Alabama. And you get to sit with white supremacists, and you get to sit with those that aren't. And you know what you do? You listen. And you hold space together. You take what Mary held at the cross seriously. So what we're trying to figure out, how we're trying to move this, is in this community. Bringing this together. Finding a way to share our ethos, our being within this area with each other. We're trying to find a way to give ourselves space, to give this breathing room in this space. Our friends need this. Do you believe that? Do the friends around you need people that can hold space for them? Our Work fellows need this. Our nephews, our nieces, our grandkids, everyone needs this. But what are we trying to figure out? Another lady that I read, Elise Edwards, talks about communal pondering, this idea where everyone is heard. And she says, in this communal form of pondering, pondering is most often a discussion in which ideas are exchanged in a conversation. And here's the beautiful thing, that honors the perspectives and the insights of all present. Man, that's the crux of this thing, is who we are. It's not just me or you, but all of us. Dr. Edwards points that out. When I was thinking about this again, as like I said, it was just bubbling up. This whole thing was just growing. I think maybe it's because I hold a lot of space for a lot of people. Thursday night, I had a place, and I have a desk. I told Karen, have you ever seen that little the Snoopy cartoon, Charlie Brown cartoon, and what's her name? I've lost her mind.
Lucy
is sitting behind a little desk, and it says the doctor's in, psychiatry doctor's in, if 5 cents. I feel like that. I'm not a psychiatrist. Neither was Lucy, so it's okay. But I was sitting there in a space of 2 hours holding the idea of a mom who's trying to figure out for a son who's in prison, or is going to jail, maybe going to prison, who's had all kinds of things going on, and we spent an hour talking about that. And then she walks out, literally walks in another young person who's trying to navigate their pronouns in a world that doesn't know what that means. And they're trying to navigate the pronouns he, she. And mental health-wise, they'd found a way that the male hormones made them feel wonderful. But their desire was not to just be he, him, but to stay he and she. Wow. I didn't solve any of this, by the way, so we just listened. And that was followed by a young man who was homeless for a long time after being adopted from Cambodia, and his American parents decided they couldn't handle it, so they dumped him on the streets at 15. And now he's 30, and he's trying to figure out what to do next, and he doesn't know because he was abandoned in a camp when his biological parents were both killed during the killing fields in the late 70s. Okay. And then that followed by someone that watched someone go through domestic violence the night before. I was exhausted. Mm-hmm. I was exhausted. The variety, the moment of space.
It takes energy to hold space.
I was craving, and this that was just me, I was craving a Bible verse in the middle. It's like, so just give me a verse. I got to find a way to, what am I going to talk about? How am I going to do this? And I thought, what community do we have where somebody created a community of space holding, of diverse people, people that went, well, they would never put that group together. Why would you, oh my goodness, you would never put that person in this group. Well, Jesus, he did that. Like, why would he put people that normally fought in the same room together? It made no sense. Why would he, if he's going to change the world, why did he find the most educated people in the world? Didn't do that. He found people, and he put them together in a community. And we know he let them talk because we had these wonderful things like, hey, do you want us just to call down fire and burn that place up? No, not that way. Then he had some that's like, well, you don't let that person come in. Why are you letting that person come in? Okay, you got to let the kid come to me. Oh, so he let people talk. He let their humanness be human. And then it came down to probably one of my favorite verses. If I preach, I might preach on John 13 every time. In John chapter 13, we get another zoom into this community. This is the moment when Jesus is washing feet. It's the moment before we get to do this bread and wine here. This moment of holding space, after he'd washed their feet, he says this to them. He said, do you understand what I've done to you? I would have gone, no, absolutely not. that says, you address me as teacher and master, and rightly so. That's what I am. So if I, the master and teacher, washed your feet, you must now wash each other's feet. I've laid down a pattern for you. What I've done, you do. I'm only pointing out the obvious. A servant is not ranked above his master. An employee doesn't give orders to the employer. If you understand what I'm telling you, act like it and live a blessed life. Jesus was teaching them in our terms how to hold space, what it looks like to put a group together and do something. It's almost crazy that it's foreign to most of our world to do this. A few years ago, I was able to experience this here. It wasn't normal in my life for this to happen. The spaces that were held usually had an agenda, and most of the time, I wasn't it. If I had to put my voice into it, I had to, like, put myself into it until I came here. I was able to join the leadership council. I'm looking at Vanessa because she was, and knowingly, was one of the beautiful teachers of this. At our first meeting, and I heard Vanessa say something about money, or I don't even remember what the subject was, but Vanessa Bain mentioned something, and she didn't mention it as, this is the way it is. She mentioned it as, consider this. And everybody did. And I looked around waiting for the, it never happened. And then I got to experience that. I got to experience that space on our leadership council where everyone's voices mattered. Now I can see Charlie McKay. I can look around this room and see folks that I shared that space with. Sharing those moments within this, talking about what we're trying to do here, held in a way to say, and that we've heard from everybody on this half of the room, you guys be quiet, and we're going to listen to this half of the room. And in a room, we're going, we all look the same. Something's wrong here. Let's work on that. A space that was held with loving kindness. This community covenant was lived out there. So it was all good. And then even when I was preparing this sermon, I was like, ooh, Robbie, that's all nice and woo-woo and sounding great. And then I read this guy. Therapist Jeff Kim. Got his picture up there, I hope. There he is. Guess what his nickname is by that picture? You may know him as the angry therapist. I love this guy. And I thought, Robbie, you can stand up there and wax on all day about all this, ooh, let's all feel good and move together. Jeff Kim helped me narrow down this. This is pretty much the sermon. This is pretty much why we need to do this. This is the how we do of what we're trying to do with this. He says, if you do not have the ability to hold spaces, the relationship will not have legs. Because unsafe spaces encourage people to hide, to not truly show themselves. It blocks trust, creates drift. The relationship becomes wobbly or pseudo, false and surfacey. This means ceilings. The relationship cannot grow and thrive. It is now stunted. Nothing wrong doesn't mean nothing's wrong. We can be nice and share laughs, but there will be no deepening that changes people in a way that promotes individual evolution. If spaces are not held, holding space is a big, and I'll tell you, I deleted a word I debated. Oh, do I say it? But he says, holding spaces is a big deal. It is. He says, if people aren't holding space for you, you are not becoming. Instead, you are only surviving. And surviving isn't living. It's standing in comfort, which is called being stuck. Amen. Brass tacks right there. Brass tacks. This is why we do this. This is why this space, this is why this container is in the community covenant. We hold space for one another. And we learn how to do that together. The community covenant that we have offers us four ways of doing this. four ways of how we do this in our place here. The first one, we listen with curiosity to understand. We're listening for understanding. We're not listening to the point where we get a thought in our head and then we stop listening. We're not listening so we have our comeback and then go again. Everyone's perspective is needed. We need everyone here. We need to be proactive to ensure diversity of voices is present, and we're doing that here. We need to stay attuned to how much space you are taking up. This one, I want to finish on, because this one's me. I'm 6'5", 250 pounds. I could take up a lot of space. But I want you guys to know something. I'm going to share this as a personal thing. A lot of times, when something's going on, if there's conflict or in a room is not being held for me, my inner self is about 4 foot tall, 80 pounds. I don't realize how big I am outwardly, because when space is not being held safely for me, I'm very, very small. And so if I do this, in my mind, I'm trying to find space, and I'm really taking up a lot of physical space. So I have to stay attuned. It's one of my processes I work on in holding space. Stay attuned to how much physical space you're taking up, emotional space you're taking up, and actually what you need to take up. Because you may not be taking up enough space, and you need to take up more. Highlands, as we move through this community covenant, as we reflect on Mary, as we reflect on her pondering, as we reflect on the way Dr. Holmes described the black church as it survived through all the centuries, as we think about our angry therapist, this is a big deal. It's a big deal to Jesus. It was such a big deal to Jesus that he washed feet. Mm-hmm. He washed feet. This week, as you move, as you hold space, as you realize where you are and who's with you, may you start by washing feet. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for this time. Thank you for this people. Father, help us to be a covenant people that see the past, that see the present, and hold the future together. Thank you for your love. Thank you for giving us strength. It's in Christ we pray. Amen. Amen.